Okay, everyone, welcome to join today's space observation and sustainability course. And today's lecturer is Professor Tang Huang Lin. He's from Center for Space and Remote Sensing Research. And his research interests are remote sensing of source partition and data assimilation of particulate matter pollution. Okay, Professor Lin, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for Dr. Yang's introduction. So welcome to today's course related to the air pollution. So right now I will share the material. Okay, yeah, thanks. So now I will start to introduce the remote sensing topic related to the aerosol partition and the estimation of PM2.5. I'm Tang Huang Lin from Center for Space and Remote Sensing Research, National Central University in Taiwan. So here is the outline of today's topic, including the impact of the atmospheric aerosols. What's the importance of the atmospheric aerosols? And since the aerosol is very important related to a lot of issues, we need to monitor and how to monitor so-called the atmospheric aerosols. Actually, the first thing you need to do is try to identify what kind of the suspended particle, including the type identification, as well as their mixing status. That is a kind of weighting partition when there are lot of the mixed particles. And finally, this is the kind of general limitation related to the observation of vertical distribution of atmospheric aerosols. Once you can identify or sense the atmospheric aerosols, then people would like to relate it to the PM2.5, not only the concentration, but also the main components. we just can get the information of related to the PM2.5 concentration currently. But the major component actually is another important information, no matter related to the global warming or climate change, as well as the public health. So at the end, we hope to construct the three-dimensional PM2.5 data set for the further analysis, especially for the numerical forecasting related to the PM concentration, as well as their spatial distribution. So that's the outline of today's presentation. For the impact, right now, you should see animation related to how the air pollution transported in global scale. So as you can see, there are a lot of pollutant suspend in the air, including the biomass burning, stand in green color, and the mineral dust in yellow actually, as well as the sea salt, and the white spume actually indicate the sulfate or nitrate emitted from the industrial area actually. So although this animation is a kind of the simulated, but actually it could be pretty similar to the reality which we have currently. Okay, so since the suspend particle of the aerosol is obvious, so actually it should result in a lot of effect, including the global issue in warming or climate change. By the way, when people talking about the global warming and the first target we can imagine is about the greenhouse gases, but actually the suspend particle, so-called the aerosol, is also important as well, especially when you try to give an accurate estimation related to the impact from each parameter or each factor. For the climate change, as you can see, when people talking about the climate change, it should be focused on two main parameter. The first one should be the temperature. The other one should be the rainfall rate or precipitation. When the spatial and temporal distribution are not regular or tend to be pretty different, we may call it the climate change already. Okay, so the animation actually is a kind of a scheme related to the impact of atmospheric aerosol on regional precipitation. Based on the animation, you can see there are some dust storm outbreak and the forest fire or open fire, and as well as anthropogenic pollutant. Since the heavy loading of atmospheric aerosols could be provided more nucleoide for the cloud formation, so that once they can provide heavy loading of aerosols, then a lot of the cloud could be formed. And once the cloud formed, then the incoming solar radiance could be much reduced, resulting in less water vapor emitted from the surface. So that although there are a lot of cloud format, but the cloud particle could be just a little bit, I just mean cannot grow due to the lack of the surface water vapor provided. So the heavy loading heavy loading of air pollutant region actually equipped with less precipitation. So the video actually just try to describe the concept related to the atmospheric aerosol to the regional precipitation. And the IPCC report in 2013 also indicate or try to summarize the key parameters for the climate change. According to their report, as you can see, there are four major components or factors related to the climate change. Actually, the key is focused on the energy budget. Okay, so the summarized four key parameters include the greenhouse gases, as well as the land surface, land use and land cover type, as well as the atmospheric aerosols. Okay, so another factor, of course, should be incoming solar radiance. So let me show you the scheme related to the Earth's energy budget. Actually there are two kinds of energy budget in Earth system. The one should be incoming solar radiance, especially within so-called the short wave flux. And the other part actually is the outgoing long wave radiation. So when the incoming energy equal to outgoing energy, the system could be stay in a stable status. However, when the content within the Earth system changed, and then the transportation or the procedure in radiation budget could be changed as well. So for example, the greenhouse gases effect could be result in keeping more energy within the long wave spectral band, which may potentially outgoing to the deep space. So more energy could be kept by the greenhouse gases, and the higher temperature could be resulted in. That's the main, that's the main scheme or mechanism related to the greenhouse gases related to the global warming effect. And for the short wave flux part, actually not only cloud in before, as we all know, but also aerosols can be involved. So if you look back to the effect provided by the IPCC, then you will see actually not only the cloud effect, but also the atmospheric aerosol itself. And if you look at the difference between the mean value as well as their dynamic range or variation, then you will get the information related to the obvious fluctuation. The obvious fluctuation actually is very important for the assessment of the impact for the atmospheric aerosol. Actually, for example, if you don't have any information, then most people just can use the mean value to describe the impact from the aerosol. However, the mean value, the reality related to the mean value could be have two times difference. For example, if the atmospheric particle equipped with a very strong absorption effect, then it could be provide a positive contribution related to the Earth's radiation budget. However, the particle equipped, if the particle equipped with a very strong scattering capability, then the effect should be much enhanced in negative contribution. So how to identify or how to mapping the dynamic range actually is essential for the accuracy assessment. And unfortunately, most of the aerosol suspended in the air are not only one type. I mean, the situation is usually mixed type of atmospheric aerosols. For example, for the region indicated by the arrow, actually made the combination from sulfate as well as the dust. So if you just consider about the impact from the pure or one type only, then it should have some uncertainty already. So this is the update. The former one actually did not consider about the aerosol impact for the Earth radiation budget in the procedure. However, considering their impact actually, the new one already update to include the impact of the aerosols. And how about what's the aerosols? So the general definition of the atmospheric aerosols is that the all of the materials suspended in the air exclude the gases and the water vapor. Okay, so in short, exclude the gases suspended in the air and the water vapor, the remaining material, you can call it aerosols. So that is the aerosols, mostly a kind of air pollution, a kind of air pollutant. Okay, so that's why when people talking about the aerosol, it could be highly related to the air pollution or air pollutant. Okay. So for the atmospheric aerosol impact, not only on the Earth's radiation budget, which related to the global warming or climate change, but also highly related to the public health, which already emphasized by the IPCC assessment report 6th version. Okay, so actually the atmospheric aerosol is very important, so that we need to monitor. We need to monitor. And another related to the public health report provided by the WHO point out that about 7 million deaths per year in the world. Okay, and that is about 7 million people die because of the air pollution. So the bottom panel actually indicate the spatial distribution related to the deaths caused by the air pollution. So based on the data set, as you can see, the major region could be within the Asia, Australia, as well as Africa. So especially the Asia and Africa, almost more than half percentage, half percentage of the global deaths caused by the air pollution. And the factor could be include the stroke and the heart disease and the cancers and so on. So actually the spatial distribution could be related to the loading impact. However, the different disease could be
Hello sir,
sorry? Any problem? Any problem? No? If no problem, I will continue. Okay, for the disease, should be caused by different species. That is the different type or major component of suspended particle. So the global observation of aerosol is essential. And right now, we do have the lot of challenge in the observation of atmospheric aerosols, especially the limitation, the limitation related to or limitation of point measurement from each stations. So if the remote sensing, the satellite observation, since it can provide the global information. So if the satellite observation can provide the detailed information related to the global aerosols or suspended particle, it could be better. It could be better. So for the challenge related to the remote sensing of atmospheric aerosol could be described by the following panel. So the equation shown here actually is the definition of aerosol optical depths retrieved or observed from satellite observation. The total column, since the satellite observation provide the total column of atmosphere information. So it should be affect from top of the atmosphere down to the surface. Okay, and depends on so-called the concentration of suspended particle associated with their capability in scattering or absorption. So it means that when you try to estimate the concentration of the suspended particle, then according to the total column optical depths, then you need the extra information of the type as well as vertical distribution. Okay, so mostly in the general situation, people cannot get such kind of information, including the major component, the type information, as well as the vertical distribution. So people just can use the button formula to estimate the PM concentration based on the satellite observation of total current optical depth. So actually it is a lot of the uncertainty could be induced when you apply such kind of formula. So if the satellite observation can provide the type as well as the vertical distribution, then the uncertainty or the issue could be dealt with or overcome. Okay, and actually here also include the water vapor effect, especially for the water vapor soluble suspend particle such as sulfate and nitrate and so on. So for this kind of challenge the focal point of remote sensing technology focus on the first one, of course, aerosol type identification. And since most suspend particle is not one or pure type, so that you had better to equip the function to partition the missing status for the mixed type of the suspend particle. And the next one, of course, should be try to fitting the vertical distribution. And once you can fitting the vertical distribution associated with the two-dimensional observation from the satellite image, then you can try to construct the three-dimensional information related to the atmospheric aerosols. And for the PM2.5, just like the relationship of definition of aerosol optical depths, once you can provide the vertical distribution associated with different components, including their missing status, then the PM concentration actually can be estimated more accurate. So if you want to provide the more comprehensive information, then the satellite observation could be the best choice currently if you can provide or organize or develop such kind of algorithm for the satellite observation. Okay, so for the first challenge, could the satellite remote sensing can identify the pure type as well as try to partition or identify the mixing status? In general, for the aerosol type identification, we usually apply two kinds of physical parameter, including the particle size as well as the capability in absorbing or scattering. So here the button, the upper table just coming or collected from the in situ measurement from different site. So here is just an example related to how the pure type aerosol observed from the in situ measurement. Okay, so for the dust particle, as you can see, in particle size parameter, they actually equip or display a kind of coarse, bigger particle size, and equipped with the central of the scattering property. And for the biomass burning, is a kind of the smoke from open fire, because the burning open fire of the open fire is a kind of incomprehensible combustion. So a lot of the component of black carbon could be produced. So actually for the biomass burning, the major component could be the black carbon. And for the black carbon, actually normally equipped with smaller particle size, and also equipped with strong absorption capability. And the other type, which may coming from industrial activity, so we just call it anthropogenic pollutant. So the particle size of anthropogenic pollutant mostly coming from the sulfate or nitrate, actually. So the particle size is a little bit larger, smaller value indicate larger particle size. So it is a little bit larger than the black carbon, and the pretty strong in scattering capability compared to the biomass burning. So according to such kind of summarize, then you should get the concept or the idea. When you try to identify the dust particle from the other type, you may use the particle type, particle size information. However, the particle size information actually is pretty limited to separate the black carbon from the sulfate or nitrate, so that they but they equipped with pretty different difference in absorption or scattering capability. So if you want to separate these two kind of particle, then you had better to use the information about the absorption as well as the scattering information. However, for the satellite observation, actually it is pretty hard to provide such kind of information. This is current limited for the satellite remote sensing related to the particle type identification. However, in addition to the scattering and absorption, the data related to the aerosol optical depth is much easier to be obtained from satellite observation. So if you look at the different type, the trend, I just mean the trend of spectral aerosol optical depths, then you will see actually it may have some potential to separate the different type according to the spectral aerosol optical depth. For example, if you look at the slope of the spectral optical depth, then you can see a little bit different. So is it possible to use such kind of difference to separate or identify the major component of the suspend particle. So we actually try to identify or examine such kind of hypothesis which based on the stop difference for type identification. So this is a kind of the examination or testing. So according this is the result from the collect data set just showing in the table, as you can see. So if you look at the number in slope, as you can see for the dust, actually is quite different from the anthropogenic as well as biomass burning, which can be potentially applied to. But if you look at the value between anthropogenic and biomass burning, although they can identify in the value, but if you look back to the scatter plots, then you will see or get the understanding related to the limitation, just like what I mentioned here. So if you use the particle size to identify the dust, mineral dust over the land region, actually it is potentially available. And if you look at the particle size between the sulfate and the black carbon, then it may limit it. So that's the problem showing based on or according to the in situ measurement. So for more detail or improvement, you had better go back to the principle or mechanism. So if you look back to the empirical relationship between aerosol optical type, depth, as well as the particle size, then the slope actually can be expressed by the second formula. So the result of second formula just expressed on the depth panel. And the detail, if you rewrite the second formula, then you will get the third formula. Based on the third formula, actually you may get the more detailed information, which the slope actually not only the function of the particle size, but also the loading itself. So if you want to exclude the effect of the loading, then you may get the real or more reality or related to the particle size information. Okay, since the A and the B are constant value. So the general way to exclude the loading effect, just move the total amount of loading to the defense side as the formula shown here. And if you replot the scatter plots, then you will get more clear information related to the particle size distribution for each aerosol type. So for example, here is the dust particle, anthropogenic, and black carbon. So again, as you can see, actually a lot of overlapping region still can be found from the scatter plots. However, the effect of particle size already independent to the concentration is the panels shown here. The different panel actually indicate the different reference of the normalization. Okay. So actually they indicate the same concept or same mechanism. However, if you look more detail into the each pit panel, then you still can find some uncertainty. For example, actually within the range between dust particle and the anthropogenic most situation could be assumed is that the mixing material between or from dust particle and anthropogenic, but actually you still can find some black carbon located here in this region. So actually this is not enough only use the particle size distribution to identify the pure type of the aerosols. So we need to consider the other parameter which try to separate more accurately. Okay, so the general concept related to the particle size distribution is the first order derivative of spectral aerosol optical depth. It means that when you have the spectral optical depth, then if you take the first order derivative, then the result could be related to particle size, just like the result shown here, okay, after normalization. And if you can provide more than three spectral optical depths, then you will be able to take this second order derivative, and the result could be related to the absorption as well as the scattering, so that you can get the another information. So in this study, or proposed approach, not only the particle size distribution, but also the scattering and the absorption characteristic could be applied into the identification of the aerosol type. Okay, and once you can identify the major type, then how to partition the mixing waste. The panel shown here actually give you the concept related to the mechanism. Actually, this is a kind of general way people apply it. So for example, if you have a value located in blue point, then according to the mean value of A type and the B type, then you will be able to identify or estimate the fraction between type A and type B according to the distance, between beam value. So that's the fundamental concept related to the mixing weight partition. But in our final algorithm, we actually did not use such kind of partition. We just partition the missing weight according to the model simulation, which I will introduce you later. Okay, so the AOD fraction of dual type mixture can be described by the formulas, especially the bottom formula, actually. And this is already introduced. So the above analysis actually is just according to the in situ measurement. And when we try to apply or to be a kind of operational procedure, then we had better consider about the model simulation. Okay, so the model simulation, the result of model simulation actually also support which the result from the in situ measurement. So actually, I should say the in situ measurement actually support the model simulation as the following. Okay, so if you consider about the different type of aerosol in different loading as the first panel shown here, then the first, this is a kind of the spectral aerosol optical depth calculated by the model simulation. And if you take the first order derivative, it means that you want to estimate the particle size information. The result can be displayed as the second panel shown. So for the mineral dust, they may pretty consistent, but for the other type, including the AP and the biomass burning, actually they just separate according to the different loading in aerosol optical depths. However, if you take the normalization, then you can see most of the loading effect could be erased, so they merge to be a single information, single parameter. Okay, so this is the result actually is quite or pretty similar to the in situ measurement. Vice versa, if you take the second order derivative to get the information related to the scattering capability or absorption capability, then after normalization, then you still can get the similar information for each aerosol component. So based on such kind of result, then if you can input the mixed aerosol information into the model simulation, then at the eventually you can construct such kind of database. For example, the point stand for the pure 100% of biomass burning particles and anisotropy as well as dust particle. Then you may input some fraction or some component of the dust particle into the simulation. Then the result just follow the this line and use or repeat the similar procedure or similar simulation, then you can get such kind of database actually. So the result indicate once you can construct such kind of database and point on the information, for example, the first order derivative after normalization and second order derivative after normalization, then you will be able, you will be able to get, for example, you have a case study, then according to the first and second order derivatives, point on the database according to the location, then you will be able to get the mixing weight for each component directly. So this is what we try to apply for the satellite observation algorithm. And the next one, actually, we should validate with the in-situ measurement to assess what's the performance with such kind of database. Okay, so the panel shown here actually is a kind of comparison between the model simulation as well as the in-situ measurement. So the result shown here actually is quite consistent. So it means that actually for such kind of pre-constructed model actually can be applied for the partitions of aerosols. So we just try to apply to the satellite observation. Here I showed the Aquamodis as the example. As we all know, according to the satellite observation, then we can retrieve the aerosol optical depth according to their transmittance. And then according to the multiple or spectral aerosol optical depths, of course, we can get the first derivative like related to the particle size distribution. And then try to identify the mixing weight of each aerosol type as the panel on the right-hand side shown here. So different color indicate different type with the fraction, different fraction. So for example, the brown one here indicate there is mixed aerosols from anthropogenic and the dust particle. And actually, we would like further validate to confirm whether the identification of aerosol weightings are not accurate or not. So fortunately, the Calypso, which can provide the subtype product along with their satellite track is indicated by the blue curves. So for example, for the region C, almost dominated by the pure dust and quite consistent with our identification or proposed identification. And for the region D, actually, as you can see, the color in brown from Calypso indicate the polluted dust. It means that the pure type of dust mixing with other type of the aerosol. And the region A, actually, the proposed approach displayed the smoke, the biomass burning in black carbon dominate. And for their observation or product also support such kind of observation. by the way, the black color here indicate the small plume from the Calypso product. So actually, the black color is same as the green color in our result. Okay, so by this way, of course, you can apply all of the satellite observation. For example, the case here in 2014 and 2016. So not only the loading, but also the aerosol type with fraction can be provided. Okay, so the detailed validation could be provided not only from the satellite observation from other product, but also the in situ measurement actually. So here is the reference we applied to validate our result in aerosol type identification, just mentioned before. So this is the one of the product which can provide from Calypso satellite observation. And y-axis indicate the vertical information, and the x-axis indicate the locations, and the different color indicate different subtype of suspended particle. For example, the one in blue color indicate the marine type, which seesaw dominate, and the number two indicate the pure type of the dust, and the number five indicate the mixed type with the mineral dust, and six smoke from open fire is a kind of the open fire. And the third one in red actually indicate the continental pollutant mostly coming from human activities. And with such kind of the information associated with the vertical distribution in extinction product, then we will be able to calculate the aerosol optical depth for each type according to the definition of aerosol optical depth again. So the fraction can be defined by the top formula. So this is the result which we compare with. So in aerosol type, so as you can see, it is pretty consistent. So the result actually, or the proposed approach can apply to the global scale, since satellite observation can provide the global observation. So this is an example in spring, summer, different season in 2015. The type, the different color indicate the different suspended particle which appeared frequently for the each location. Okay, so by this way, actually, we can go back to try to respond try to respond the dynamic range related to the radiative forcing. So the dynamic indicate here is not the uncertainty, actually is a kind of temporal or spatial resolution of the spatial atmospheric error source. So if you only can provide the pure type of the error source, then it cannot satisfy to provide or to mapping such kind of requirement. For example, the panel on the left-hand side just indicate you the incoming shortwave radiance or flux on the surface level. And if you just can't have or provide the pure type, then you just can indicate a few certain location. And once you can provide all of the mixed type information, then you will be able to identify the whole impact or the dynamic range for the specific region or study area. So once you can provide the type identification, including the mixing weights, then you will be able to provide the dynamic range related to the radiative forcing for the further more accurate assessment. Okay, so I will stop here for 10 minutes break. Before the break, is there any question? Or maybe you can have your question after the break. Okay, so we will take a break about 10 minutes and go back here at 5 o'clock. Okay, should we continue? Yeah, the next topic I would like to introduce is about the vertical distribution fitting. So actually, the issue it is a little bit complicated. But however, actually, it is pretty limited for the satellite observation or the in situ measurement, so that we had better try to divide it. And for the proposed approach is that according to the in situ measurement in Taiwan, so this panel just show you the vertical distribution in different season, including the spring, summer, autumn, and winter. So the pattern of vertical distribution actually is a kind of the log normal distribution function. If you don't have the vertical distribution information, then most people just assume under the boundary layer, the material could be well mixed so that they may have the constant concentration. And above the boundary layer, they may according to the exponential decay distribution. So vertical distribution could be like this way, but in compare with the observation, actually they still have some difference. So in order to have more accurate information, so we try to fitting the vertical distribution of aerosol with the so-called the log normal distribution. And according to the definition of aerosol optical depth observed from the satellite, the integration of the extinction profile actually could be defined as the total column of optical depths. And for the fitting of the function, we still need another information because to identify a specific normal distribution, we need two parameter, including the mean value as well as the standard deviation. So we still need another information to estimate the both mean and the standard deviation of normal distribution. And if you look at the observed vertical distribution, then you will see, especially when you compare summer distribution with winters, then you will see in summer actually vertical distribution could be broad, and the winter winter could be a narrow one. It could be much affected by the boundary layer high. Boundary layer high. So by considering such kind of the fact, so that we select the boundary layer high as the second parameter for fitting the vertical distribution. And once such actually this currently this is just a kind of hypothesis. So before we propose the algorithm, we want to do some test. For example, we take a measurement from the stations, from the station, and try to fit the vertical distribution with normal, log normal distribution by manual. Then the result can be shown on the left hand side. As you can see, the green, actually there is another red curve which overlap together, is much consistent with the in situ measurement. So the result actually indicate it maybe can be applied potentially. So that we just try to collect the in situ measurement about 10 years observation, and then try to fitting the vertical distribution with the normal distribution manually. Then after that kind of procedure, we do have the data set related to the mean and the standard deviation information. And according to the total column optical depths associated with boundary layer high, then we will be able to try to construct the relationship between these two data sets. and since the boundary layer height varied with each season. So we just separate or construct the relationship seasonal. So this is a kind of result. So as you can see on this on the table, the correlation between these two data sets are pretty good, pretty good. Indicate that the proposed approach could be available. Okay, so that is once we can construct the relationship between these two data sets for each season, then once you can get the information of total column optical depth with the boundary layer height, like the case shown here. So we may have the aerosol optical depth in total column from satellite observation in each case, and associated with the boundary layer height coming from a numerical weather model, then associated with our constructed relationship in between, then we will be able to have the mean value as well as the standard deviation for the log normal distribution in each pixel. Okay, so after we get the sigma and mean value, then we will be able to have a vertical distribution in three dimensional. Okay, and about the validation, actually, this is a kind of the comparison between the fitting result on the bottom panel and the in situ measurement. So as you can see, the validation result indicate the proposed approach actually is available for vertical distribution fitting. So that by this way, we can get a three-dimensional observation or information related to the atmospheric aerosols. And what else? If you talking about, so far we already can construct the three-dimensional extinction coefficient, but for the PM2.5 estimation, actually, it's still affected by the water vapor effect. So we would like to examine the water vapor effect for the correction in the relationship between PM2.5 and the aerosol optical depth. So take the soot aggregate as the example. So the water vapor effect indicated by the relative humidity. So the same situation, if under the relative humidity about 50%, the situation could be displayed by the A item. And when the RH increased to be 70%, then the not only the particle size grows, but also the shape already changed 80 and 90. Okay, so we just use the model simulation to calculate the variation or the difference or the changes in optical property. Okay, so consider the relative humidity situation and take the soot aggregate as the example. Then according to cluster to cluster aggregation and the GMM to mean scattering to calculate their optical property, and this is a kind of a result. So the result shown in table just indicate you, if you don't consider about the water vapor effect, for example, if you don't consider the water vapor effect, the single scattering albedo in 0.47 is about 0.15, but under the situation of relative humidity about 70%, the single scattering albedo could be increased to be 0.21. So it is about 30 to 40% in difference. So you had better to consider about the water vapor effect when you try to convert the optical depth to the PM concentration. Okay, so this is a kind of analysis related to each factor. For example, take the dust anthropogenic and the biomass as the example. When you don't consider the water vapor effect, the correlation coefficient, especially for the sulfate or nitrate kind of soluble particle, then the relationship could be pretty different. Okay, so right now we already consider or deal with about the type with the here. So right now, we already consider about the type as well as the vertical distribution and the water vapor effect. So it means that actually we can estimate the PM concentration more accurately based on also optical depth. So the only thing we need to do is that the relationship between aerosol optical depths like this one with the PM concentration. Actually, different region could be equipped with different relationship. I just mean a little bit difference. So for the relationship between aerosol optical depths and PM2.5, we would like to construct it by yourself according to the in-situ measurement. And so the data set we need to collect include aerosol optical depths as well as the PM2.5 concentration, as well as relative humidity. According to the spectral aerosol optical depth, then we can further process the major component or major type of mixed aerosols, as well as associated with the boundary layer height. We can also fit in the vertical distribution. and associated with the relative humidity, then the relationship between PM2.5 and the aerosol optical depth can be eventually constructed. So this is the relationship between aerosol optical depths, aerosol optical depths, and the PM2.5 concentration by considering water vapor effect. Okay. So once the relationship between aerosol optical depth and PM2.5 constructed, then we can construct the three-dimensional PM2.5 by or from satellite observation. So here just show you an example. So firstly, according to the satellite observation in Taiwan, and associated with the boundary layer height from weather model, then we will be able to construct the vertical distribution of aerosol optical depths. And the further step, once we can get the vertical distribution, then we can extract the surface layer in aerosol optical depths. And then according to their type related to estimate the PM2.5 concentration. So this is the case, the result of the case in 2017. And the estimate PM2.5 concentration compared with the in situ measurement from these stations, as you can see, the correlation or the result is pretty good, pretty good. So especially if you look at the relationship, the linear relationship between estimate PM2.5 and the stations of the PM2.5, the scale is close to one. It means that it is the result is pretty accurate, and the offset may be a kind of system error. Okay, so currently, here we just apply the polar satellite, observation. As we all know, the polar satellite observation just can provide one observation per day. If you want to, as we all know, the aerosol varied obviously with tempo as well as the location special. So if you want to use one observation for the daily mean, actually the representative is not satisfied. So if we can apply such kind of approach to the geostationary satellite data, for example, in Asia, call it Himawari 8, and in the Pacific, it can be provided from GOES 16. Since they equipped with multiple spectral with better temporal resolution, so that once we can apply, then the monitoring in near real time could be achieved. So as you can see, on the left hand side is a kind of a two color image from RGB, red, green, blue spectral band every 10 minutes. And according to the retrieval algorithm, then it can be provide the spectral aerosol optical depth. And once you can get spectral aerosol optical depth, then it will be able to provide more detailed information related to atmospheric aerosols. For example, here is the pollution event occurred in the southern part of the Taiwan. Actually, is a kind of agricultural waste burning. If you look at their optical depths as well as their single scattering orbital, then you you may get the information in near real time. I just mean every 10 minutes. Okay, every 10 minutes. So it is pretty good for the operation tools. Okay, so if you focus on the exposure risk, the satellite data in detail, PM2.5 or aerosol information actually can be provided. The proposed approach actually is pretty helpful for such kind of analysis related to the exposure risk. And again, this is the global situation. So on the right hand side, based on about 16 years measurement or observation from satellite, we can provide the annual distribution of PM2.5, both in concentration on the bottom panel as well as the major type on the top panel. And such kind of information actually is pretty good for the further analysis related to the not only exposure risk but also disease cause. And of course, as you can see, the result provided from WHO shown here, according to the PM concentration, the Asia as well as Africa actually could be the major regions, as you can see. And if you look at the standard situation or standard criteria which provided from the WHO in annual and the daily exposure standard, then you will see for the annual standard actually currently all of the global region are over the standard exposure already. Okay, so with the satellite observation, actually it could provide the detail and the much information for the related research or issues analysis. Okay, so of course this is a kind of result related to each component including the anthropogenic biomass as well as dust impact in different regions, including agriculture, for example, America, Asia, Europe, and the other region. Okay, so once we can construct a three-dimensional PM2.5 concentration associated with different major type, then it could be much helpful for us to provide the information required for operational forecast. So as we all know, currently, the initial data is just a kind of two-dimensional information according to the land use, land cover type. However, the model, dispersion model actually equipped with three-dimensional function. And normally, if you just provide two-dimensional for three-dimensional forecast, then the uncertainty, of course, should be obvious. So once you can, if you can provide the three-dimensional for the model, then the operational potential could be expected. Okay, so I think that's all for today's topic. So the conclusion remark, including based on satellite observation associated with a proposed approach, not only the pure type can be identified, but also the mixing status can be provided. And we also can provide the vertical distribution of the aerosol, atmospheric aerosols. So it is it could be much improvement for the lack of such kind of information. The further construction of three-dimensional PM 2.5 concentration actually is pretty helpful for the further assessment and the forecast and the policy making as well. Okay, so I think I just briefly introduced the current achievement or the development related to remote sensing of air pollution. And this is the reference. So including the identification of aerosol type as well as mixing weight partition, the first paper. And the second paper is just try to fitting the aerosol distribution in vertical. And the third one actually is a kind of exposure risk assessment related to the effect of the PM 2.5 on global scale. Okay, so I think that's all for this topic.
Okay.
If you have any question, I would be happy to answer. Thank you.
Thanks for Professor Lin. Anyone have any question? You can raise your hand or write down. Okay, I see. Lin Qihong.
Okay, so good afternoon, Professor. So I have one question. So just like you said, we can use a satellite and we can be known for how much the PM 2.5 and also air pollution in the ground. But my question is PM 2.5, let's say the particle.
Yeah.
Cloud inside the water, they also see a particle.
Yep.
The fog inside the water, they also see a particle. So how the satellite to differentiate this air pollution and fog in a cloud? Because if they do some mistake, it might be maybe this place, the air quality is pretty good, but because the fog shows in the satellite data will be a bad air quality area.
Yes, this is a good question. Actually, it also a kind of a challenge related to the remote sensing. Normally, we just try to use the absorption band from water vapor. Okay, so most of the water vapor effect region can be filtering out. Then the remain we just try to process. So it still includes some water vapor content within the suspend particle. So that that's why we need to consider the water vapor effect, as I mentioned at the last part of this material. So for your question, in brief, we need to detect the water vapor before we process the PM2.5 information.
So how about the one serious air pollution area but coated by cloud? Can satellites still correct to know the displaced air pollution level?
No. Once the area covered by the cloud, we just skip it. Because the spectral we applied actually is visible spectral band cannot penetrate the cloud layer, so that we cannot get the information under the cloud cover region on the surface. So the first or the pre-processing of aerosol detection could be cloud detection for study.
Okay, thank you, Professor.
Yeah, no problem.
Any more questions? If no more questions, thank you, Professor Lin.
Yeah, welcome.
And there are two questions. Please write down your answer word for these two questions in the Google Form.